up for righteousness. Stand up for justice. Stand up for truth.
I truly believe that thoughts are the greatest vehicle to change.
We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
Victory in spite of all terror. Victory however long and hard the road may be.
To those waiting with bated breath for that favorite media catchphrase, the U-turn, I have only one thing to say. U-turn if you want to. The ladies not for turning.
We do not care whether the cat is black or white, as long as it can catch mice.
Hello and welcome to the No Limitations podcast, a show where we talk to people who have achieved outstanding success in their careers and discovering the influences that have shaped their destinies. I'm your host, Greg Robinson, Managing Partner of Blenheim Partners Executive Search and Board Advisory Firm. Today I'm joined by Fergus McLachlan, Commander of Forces Command in the Australian Army. This role includes the responsibility to raise, train and sustain more than three quarters of the Army, from initial training of soldiers and officers through to the generation of deployable combat brigades and contemporary enabling capabilities such as cyber and electronic warfare and manned and unmanned aircraft systems. Gus's service career has included command and staff roles in Australia and overseas. Roles have included modernisation plans, operations and personnel functions, and representative placements in the Australian Parliament staff and the Office of the US Secretary for Defence. He is deployed to operations in the Israeli occupied territories, Lebanon and Iraq. Most recently, he completed a 12-month tour with the International Security Assistance Force in Afghanistan, where he was the senior campaign planner in joint command. For his service in Afghanistan, Major General McLachlan was awarded the U.S. Legion of Merit by the Secretary for Defense, James Mattis. Today, we will be discussing modern leadership in complex, disrupted organizations. Welcome to the show, Gus.
It's great to be here, Greg. Thanks for having me.
Gus, what really is Commander of Forces Command?
You know, it's my equivalent in Navy is called the Fleet Commander. The equivalent in the Air Force is called the Air Commander, and I kind of just wish I was called the Land Commander. But it's a play on that. The Land Forces Command is the largest element of the Defence Force, about 36,000 people. All of Army's operational forces, less Special Operations Command, so the conventional forces in Army, if you like. And we do everything from train individual tank drivers, cyber defenders, helicopter pilots, right through to generating the, you know, the brigades, if you like, that would go offshore and do our defences business.
Big business then.
It is, and it's sometimes sounds challenging, so I just try not to think about the size of it and just work through an incredible group of people that we've got who, you know, who are passionately aligned, you know, to try and deliver an organisation that's, that, you know, that's good for Australia.
So here today to talk about leadership, what are the disruptions you see in the complex military that are also parallel to, I guess, complex business organisations, Gus? What could we learn from the military?
Yeah, look, I think there's some ageing perceptions around that, you know, military's trained for the last war and so on. The reality of our operating environment is incredibly dynamic. And you, just in my recent command journey, we went off to Afghanistan and you broadly trained to engage a direct fire enemy. So a Taliban shooting at you from behind a compound wall or a hill. And by the end of that tour, we were facing a complex improvised explosive devices that had electronic triggers that had been, you know, manufactured in other countries around the world and imported into that area. You have to very quickly learn that an organization that is patting itself on the back and satisfied is going backwards compared to somebody else. Now that's the same of the New York taxi companies in the face of the Uber disruption.
Yes.
And you know, as you move forward, we leave Afghanistan and next we find ourselves in northern Iraq, and you're facing the ISIL. Occasional small drone starts appearing over our position. Taliban never used drones to look at us. It's quite a shock. We'd had the overwhelming advantage of intelligence, surveillance, drone technology. Within 2 years, ISIL are procuring drones through shell companies all around the world. and we're starting to see mass drones. We're starting to see explosives drop from those devices. So, you know, that sort of adaption.
Is that well known to the Australian public?
Look, I think there's been a fair bit of commentary in the open source media as the technology became more rapidly available. Our adversary is cunning and ruthless and will do anything they can. So they're not going to have it delivered to, you know, ISIL position just north of Blah. Yep. They've got to find cunning ways to accumulate these things, deliver them in unmarked trucks across the border into northern Syria and Iraq. And then usually some adaptive local manufacturer, something that we all start taking for granted, things like additive manufacturing or printing our own parts. Well, if you got a clever young ISIL designer who can design a release mechanism, print the parts on a 3D printer, and then your next thing you know, you've got explosive release. So as an organization, what you have to deal with is how do you keep ahead of that adversary, anticipating where they might go, so that, you know, then are you starting to knock the drones out of the air? Are you starting to try and interdict that supply line? Where are those drones coming from? And so I think what people in industry would hear about the familiarity of that is, you've got to know what your adversary is doing. You've got to know where they're getting their stuff. You've got to have your own vision to stay ahead of that. As soon as you're being complacent, you know, an old boss used to say, if we are, you know, celebrating and stationary, somebody is going ahead of us. We're losing relative to somebody. And so that's the new environment we find ourselves in.
Has leadership changed as a result?
It has. I think the more directive style that people would perhaps see in a war movie, the George Patton jump this high.
Lower blood and guts.
Absolutely. And there's a separate time and place for what we call the command part of command and leadership, and we can come back to that. But the broader aspect of leadership that excites me is the general young kid who comes in the army to do the right thing, defend their country, and will do what they're told. If you inspire them to unlock the discretionary effort, that last 20% of their capability.
That's the same as what every business is looking for as well.
Exactly. Yep. And that's where curiosity sits. You know, that's where innovation sits. That's where cunning sits. So for us, it's about being the types of leaders that create an environment that unlock that last 20% for our young people. And what we're finding is there will be someone in our workforce who knows a little bit about drone technology, or knows a little bit about jamming, or knows a little bit about something else. And before you know it, you're getting offered ideas that if you're standoffish and directive and removed from the workforce, like perhaps not just our organisation but other older institutions might have been, you're not unlocking that last 20%.
So the word's getting up as opposed to just coming down?
The one thing they keep asking us for, Greg, is give us the understanding of the situation we're in, tell us the context, and let us make it better. And again, I think that's quite similar to every other young member of the millennial workforce out there. Our young people say, we can help you if you tell us the context. So instead of just we're going to attack Hill A, what you're explaining is the enemy on Hill A are providing, you know, cover or suppression in order to, you know, to prevent us moving through there. The old simple analogy that we use is, if the enemy move off Hill A and are on B, is our young leader at the time going to know exactly what and why they were doing there? And so every time we do that, they take that opportunity and more, and add value and create a solution that often, you know, the senior leader didn't even envisage.
So, Gus, when you first turned up and walked into the camp many years back, what was the definition of leadership in those days?
I was very lucky, and I they've been good. They've been great leaders around for a long time, but it was probably a different style of leadership in many units. I was a tank guy. Now, it sounds as a pretty traditional part of the army, but in the tank units, the leadership's pretty intimate. You're sitting in a vehicle, big steel box with three other people, and you're there 24 hours a day. And often, with, you know, if the lid's closed because you're practicing about artillery fire or whatever, you're really intimate. You're doing everything, including, you know, going to the toilet and so on.
Yep.
So you develop a leadership style that is accessible and engaged. You still, and this is one thing, a conversation I often have with young leaders, you're still not their mate. You're still their boss, but you've got to find a way to be in that environment, be engaged, be part of the team, and still find that little bit of room for separation. So I was very lucky. I learned that at a young age, and I knew I'd was starting to get the leadership formula right. I was coming back from a late night orders session with my boss giving us instructions for the next day, and I came back. I approached my tank in the dark, and there's one of the soldiers who stayed awake. He's got a hot cup of coffee. a horrible can of stew, mixed everything in one can, and my sleeping bags rolled out. And I remember standing there thinking, you know what, I think I might be going okay. And so that sort of shaping, early shaping for me, I think created a perhaps a different style of leadership than someone who might have been in a bigger, more institutional part of the army.
Discipline is key.
I think discipline and your own behaviour and standards are key. So for young leaders, I tell them, you've got to take yourself seriously. And so you're not there to be the mate or the class clown, as attractive it often is to sort of to be that figure. People working for you, particularly in these roles where at the end of the day it's a pretty significant, pretty serious business, the people working for you want to know that you're serious, you're a student of your profession, you're working as hard as you can to be as good as you can. One of my inspirations, my sister's a cancer doctor specialist in Melbourne, the first female to run St Vincent's Hospital Oncology. Okay. She was on duty in St Vincent's emergency the night of the Hoddle Street killings.
Right.
And it made me realise that my sister was in this life and death business. She had to take herself incredibly seriously, and this was her professional realm. She's a year older than me. And when you actually think about my business is ultimately preparing for that reality. Absolutely. So pretty early on, I perhaps more, some might say, you know, too much, but I took it pretty seriously right from the start.
Failures of organisations in the face of disruptive threats are caused by stale leadership, long-serving individuals. Mm. You sign up into the army, a couple of times you get the chance to move on. If not, it's a life job.
Yep.
Does that necessarily promote the best and get the best out of leadership?
Yeah, it's one of our biggest challenges, but I also think it makes us a great leadership training institution, because when you think about it, we know we're training our talent from within. An organisation that's got a bit of a gap can go shopping in a rival or somewhere else. And we do poach some good talent from the British Army, from the Kiwis, the Americans, the Marines and so on occasionally, but we know the vast majority of our people are coming within. That means we take leadership development very, very seriously. And so I had that great privilege. I probably didn't realise it as a young person. I arrived at that, my first command, a meaningful size command, was a tank squadron, about 15 tanks and 100 or so people. And I sort of stood on the back deck of the tank one afternoon and I thought, you know what, I know stuff. And I had been steadily built by great people who were investing in me over time. And I think this is something that makes our army a quite an incredible institution, this view that you are always preparing your successor. And as I move on from the army, but the thing that I take great pride in is I've sort of left a great group of people behind. I'm going to torture this quote, but I think it was Bezos who said, you know, when he was a young leader, he just told people specifically how to do something. Yeah. As he got a bit more mature, he started to tell them broadly what to do and left them some room for creativity. And yep, he knew he was a senior leader when he was picking the right people and letting them get on with it. So I think that sort of replicates my journey. I find myself in a position now thinking, you know what, we've left another great generation of people behind. These young leaders now are combat veterans, but they're significant. We've got general officers with PhDs. We've got people with strong academic and operational combat background leadership. So I think a lot of Australians probably don't sort of know the type of leaders who make up the organisation. General Adam Finlay, Commander of Special Operations Command, yep, PhD in history. Yep. And so, you know, these are the sort of people leading our Defence Force.
So what do you look for when you appoint successors along the way? What's the key things as a general?
Yeah, great question. I think you've got to decide what that leadership model and climate that you want, and you need to pick the right people to
move through. For that particular time?
Absolutely. And I think we talked a little bit earlier about wanting to inspire those people. So we want generals who are more accessible, who are willing to communicate. An interesting skill set now that I think is undervalued is is technical competence. Yep. So we are digitizing our army. We're creating a deployable Internet of Things so that every system is connected and can pass data so that we can react quicker than an adversary. You need leaders now who are technically competent. Now, I'm not a signals engineer, but I've worked hard to understand that, you know, what data packets are and what data formats are and the different protocols that you need to achieve standardization, because if you don't, then you find yourself a generation later still got systems that don't talk to each other. So technically competent, accessible, and I think those who are willing to show that character and behaviour that inspires young people. This generation want to look up and they want to be inspired. They're the values generation. They're with us because it's a noble cause. Well, they want their leaders to behave that way.
Difference is, Gus, it's life and death.
Mm.
I could lose my job with you. I could lose my life.
Mm.
One of those big things is around ambiguity tolerance, which all key leaders discuss when they're appointing senior executives. Mm. But ambiguity tolerance is, I'm walking around the corner of the building and I can't see that Taliban. Do I go forward? Do I sit here and hold back? We're going to get done in. How do you train people for the ambiguity tolerance? Because that's what headhunters like myself, when we're asked to appoint key executives, ambiguity tolerance is key.
Yeah, look, it's right at the core of everything we do. So part of the thing is you can prepare people for what I call their worst day in the office. So I've got a simple adage. Try and communicate effectively. Three rules of real estate: location, location, location. Three rules in forces command: train, train, train.
Yeah.
Every situation
rehearsal,
is training.
Rehearsal, rehearsal.
Exactly. And yeah. So I had a young fellow, I don't think he'd mind me telling his story, Seamus Donoghue, one of the best young soldiers I've met. You don't meet every soldier as a brigade commander. Mm-hmm. I'd met this young kid. I knew his father, and so I met him at the farewell barbecue. Seamus was shot through the thigh on his first patrol. We call it the nursery patrol. He's still going out with the previous battalion who are saying, don't trust that particular building or watch crossing this area. There's been IEDs here before going through that.
Whereabouts are we in Afghanistan?
So this is in Afghanistan, southern Afghanistan, and young Seamus gets shot through the thigh on his first patrol. Now, the thing that I remember most importantly about that, though, is his training behaviour just kicked in. So he returned fire, suppressed the enemy. He tourniqueted his own leg. This isn't, John Wayne stuff. This is half the, 5 centimetres of bone have been taken out with the shot. He then changes magazines and he's suppressing the enemy until the first aiders reach him, and then he blacks out through loss of blood. I was talking to him in his Brisbane hospital room. And
so he blacked out.
But at the end of that, he lost so much blood, he blacked out.
So one of his mates came through, picked him up?
By then, he'd given enough covering fire for his mates to get over and pick him up. And I was talking to him back in his Brisbane hospital bed, and he said, I feel like I tripped over the boundary line running onto the grand final. And he said, but I don't remember anything. And I said, well, here's what we saw. And I wasn't deployed at that time. I deployed afterwards. But what we saw, the battalion saw, they saw one of their best soldiers whose training kicked in perfectly. He did everything that he'd been trained to do. And every young soldier took confidence from that. They said, you know what? Our training works. Seamus, when it happened to him, he did everything right. So what that meant is we reckon we got the training right. We had made it possible for him to envisage that worst day in the office, and the training kicked in. But then you've got to be ready for, what didn't we envisage?
Yeah.
And, you remember that terrible period in Afghanistan where the green on blue killings, as they were called, yep. Afghan soldiers that were turning on us. And, I'll be honest, we probably hadn't anticipated enough of that in their training. So these people are now, our leaders are on the ground having to adjust to that challenge. How do we continue to show trust to the good Afghans that we need to partner versus being protective enough to take responsibility for our own actions? So you've done the specific training you want, but what you've also created is a mental condition for them to be agile and ready for that new change that appears.
Yeah, because the sad joke out there is always, if you bring an army guy in and there's a wall in front of them, they can just keep running up against the wall as opposed to go around them.
Mm.
So this gentleman you talked about, obviously followed through the instinct, was well trained. But what about the other guys out there in the front, about their ability to think on their own, Gus?
Yeah.
I thought that's what stood the Australian army out against many others out there. But how do you train them to think? Training is one thing. That's rehearsal.
Yeah.
But there's a situation suddenly come up. I haven't dealt with this before. Am I allowed to think laterally on my own 2 feet? Yeah. Because who else is in charge here? So where does it begin? Where does it end? When do I follow orders? And when do I say, look, you're a long way behind here. You can't quite see what's going on.
Yeah,
what happens there, Gus?
Great summary. And as you'd expect, in the army, we have a name for everything. We have this thing we call mission command. What we want a leader to be able to do is make a decision. Simple question. When I'm training younger leaders, I say, if your boss isn't here, what would he or she want you to do in this situation? And that requires some training and leadership in up front. The boss needs to have explained the situation, articulated the broader long-term objective. But once you've got that, you are expected to adjust your plan to play, the game in front of you. And it's interesting, you look at the state of the Wallabies at the moment, where there's a real feeling that they're just trying to run a bunch of set pieces from their own half of the field.
Yep.
and they're not feeling confident to play what's in front of them, take the opportunity and seize that opportunity. So we're trying to grow that same sort of mindset. You've got a set job to do. It's to achieve something. You might have to secure, I'll give you a real example. An organization, you get a tip off from the nearby Special Operations Command unit they've had a really high value Taliban leader who's leaked out of one of their things. They've tracked him on a drone, gone into a building in your village, and so young leader says to his team, right, we've got to isolate this compound, and then our clearance force is going to come over the hill and occupy
based on a certain amount of information.
That's right. So you've got that broad game plan. Everyone sort of knows what they're doing, but the next thing you've got to tell them is you've got to get in the head of that adversary. So you've got to say to these young people, this is a caged tiger. When the minute this individual feels threatened, here's what I reckon is going to happen. His bodyguards are going to come hard at us, heavy volumes of fire. He's probably the high-value target. He's going to try and leak out the back. So once everyone sort of knows that broader framework and they get into position and things start, changing, all of a sudden, before we're set, there's a bloke running out the back of a building jumping on a motorbike. Well, then you've got to be able to work out that's the high value target. My job's now changed. I've now got to do X or Y. That's the sort of dynamism that we would expect our young leaders to be involved in. And you can train them for that. You make your exercise dynamic. And so it's not a series of set plays anymore. We give them a broad understanding of their objective, but we make sure that almost every situation changes and doesn't evolve quite how they expect. And we expect them to replan.
Different forms of leadership, Gus, and different styles of how you work with people. One branch is Special Forces. How do they think compared to the regular soldier?
It's a really interesting time for us in I call my big army, not pejorative, because little army is pretty damn good.
Mm.
We have increasingly been looking at their leadership approach. The approach that now they have a tremendous advantage. We're the nursery for Special Forces, so our young kids come in. We put them through really good training. The best ones go on to, they become, for example, they become reconnaissance and sniper soldiers in our part of the army. Yep. And then they go and they do the selection test for Special Forces. Selection test is incredibly difficult, and the Special Forces get to pick the best young people in the army. Now, what that does is allow you to lead them in a different way. They've had a behavior where once you're through their gate, you're trusted and treated as an equal.
Yep.
It's one of the things we're now copying. My view is let's bring that leadership behavior across into big army. And we've introduced a new shooting technique. Now it sounds like a pretty core competency for us, but generally we sort of laid people out on mats and had them shoot on a larger scale. Special Forces one-on-one instruction, leading them through, high quality techniques. So we're copying the best behaviors out of that one-on-one learning, listening to your student, listening to their learning needs, looking them in the eye. Are they progressing at the rate that I would need? And we're seeing about a 30% improvement in the quality of our shooting. That's a pretty core competency for us.
So that
the best of that special operations leadership behavior is transportable. Now, you get a little bit of risk because not all of our young kids are that highly developed or that experienced, but we think the best of that respectful, team-based, high-quality trust, we think the best of that translates really well into our environment.
It's also a little bit different in the mindset, isn't it, too, Gus, that when you start off in the army as a young person, you guys give them discipline. This is the time we're up. This is the way you're going to fold your socks. This is the way you're going to make your bed. And this is the time for breakfast. You then make past selection. You're trusted.
Exactly.
You've got the personal discipline. Now just catch up with us and let's get moving. So there's a real mind shift in that sense, though. I.e., we're not giving you the discipline anymore. You've got the discipline. You've earned the right to be here.
That's right. There's a transition through that imposed discipline to the achievement of self-discipline.
Yep.
And that...
But different sizes. We're talking different size of numbers, aren't we?
That's right.
A couple of hundred versus 30,000 plus people.
But at the end of the day, all of our best conventional force leaders have hit the point where self-discipline is the key. And, when we are talking to business leaders, that ultimately is the individual you want working for you. This is the individual who willingly comes to work on time, who willingly adds, that discretionary effort, that extra value.
And so can think a little bit differently
as well.
And
can think on their own, on their feet. We had Dan Kieran speak to we ran a competition for our best soldiers in the command. Best 20 soldiers came in from around the organisation, around the country. and we had Dan Kieran VC speak to them. So he's a general purpose, you know, big army leader.
Yep.
I mean, what an incredible young man. So, you know, Ben Robert Smith, you know, you could genetically take him and clone him and create some of the, you know, most amazing soldiers in history. Dan is something more of an everyman, but in the heat of a battle, he looked over and saw one of his mates had been shot and they were having difficulty getting to him, exposed himself four times, ran across the top of a ridge four times in the face of enemy fire to draw that fire so that his mate could be evacuated. That's, you know, that's not normal behavior. And yet this was a young person who'd come through that system of developing, you know, discipline, but then self-discipline and then that creativity to be that leader on the hill. Now again, not everyone's going to win a Victoria Cross on a remote hill in Deripat Valley in Afghanistan, but I guess my message is
that... Yeah, but we also have the leader inside.
That's right. I think it's that leadership piece that he knew how and when to react, and because we'd sort of brought him through the training and into that release that comes with self-discipline and good training.
And your exposure, the Army to business, is there enough?
Look, I regret on two levels. We have some of the best young people in the country, and I would love employers out there to view them as an asset. There's a bit of a victim story, and it's really important we look after those we've harmed. We've just had the Invictus Games here in Sydney. I had a fair bit to do with that, and I left every day feeling, you know, just amazed by the amazing sacrifice these men and women had made, but also, you know, their incredible healing journeys. But the reality is 90% of our workforce, you know, are not harmed by their service. I talk about post-traumatic growth. So we've got great young people out there who are disciplined, self-disciplined, they're well-trained, they've got leadership. We know they've got great values. They want to be part of an organisation and buy into it and have loyalty for it. So I guess one of my messages is, you know, please view these people as a resource. We absolutely need to look after the 10% who've been harmed, and we're getting pretty good at that. We're much better than the, you know, that Vietnam era who were treated absolutely terribly. I think at the more senior levels, I think, you know, there's a lot of similarities in running a big organisation. Now, we don't have to face the market, so to speak, but we're in a pretty
competitive... Well, you've got a pretty competitive
market. Pretty competitive business. So, you know, firstly, back, you know, in Australia...
I might come back the next day if I lose my options, but you guys lose your options. There is no next day.
Yeah. Well, in Australia, you've firstly got to win resources in a competitive environment. The government's got plenty of things it can spend its money on. We've got to make a coherent case for what we do. You've then got to design your this incredibly complex range of training for any number of scenarios that could develop. So we're almost that utility midfielder. And then almost every time what comes up is different to what you anticipate. You then adapt and move forward, and you've got to lead change. You've got to take an organisation with you, big organisations that can, you know, that have to be shaped and led. So I think there are many similarities. Everything from big logistics. We have a combat service support brigade in Forces Command that delivers big logistics. We run some of the biggest heavy transport fleet in the country. Mm. We run a fleet of 80 helicopters. So we have an airworthiness and an airworthiness framework, not that dissimilar to Qantas. We have a cyber security and assurance business. So I guess my message to business leaders was, you know, is there's perhaps a resource out there. Now I should caveat this because I don't want you to pinch them while they're in. let's let them do their business. But every one of them at some point, We'll want to leave, and they'll be pretty valuable Australians, I think, for both the community and for business after that.
Gus, you and I had a chat a little while back, and one of the things I raised was that I lived overseas for a number of years in the UK, and the British soldier in the UK is held with high esteem. Mm. If you don't get a university, you may go to Sandhurst, and you'll do your time. You probably will see some theatre of war. Then you'll come back, and then you'll move into business, and it's well and truly accepted. Mm. Where do you think the brand is of the Australian Army in the mindset of the Australian public and the business? I think it could be personally elevated, but I welcome your thoughts.
Yeah, look, it's really timely question, Greg, because, you know, we've just had this bit of controversy over Virgin Airways, you know, making this sort of unilateral decision to honour veterans. That didn't sit well, I'll be honest, with most of us who are serving, just because we're not used to, you know, this is the tall poppy country. This is a country where you've chosen to serve. We've got a couple of great days a year where we get, you know, the sort of the exalted position at Anzac Day and then, you know, the 11th of November, which we just saw. Most of us reckon that's about enough, and we're volunteers, we should get on with our business. I think, though, where perhaps we see in other countries the view that that people might be better understood moving out into business, whether it's in the US or the UK, we have a pretty strong track record here into the senior public service. So the heads of both of our national intelligence agencies are former major generals, Duncan Lewis and Paul Simon, two of the best individuals I've ever worked with. Yep. And I think we see a fair bit of influence in defence industry. I reckon there's a bit of an untapped resource
Absolutely.
Sort of down the middle, which is, you know, the private sector. I do hear that, you know, when you see the post-banking Royal Commission and you're looking for people, you know, with a known ethical framework who've got the character you need, I think there are people who can anticipate disruption, who can change the culture and lead an organisation. I can name, you know, a dozen of those tomorrow. Fortunately, I'm pretty happy a lot of them are enjoying the work they do. But at some point, their partner will say, mate, we've had enough, we've moved enough, the kids are at school, or the organisation will say, hey, Gus, you're getting a bit old, you better move out of the way and let some of these young ones do their thing.
Gus, the other topic which comes up with the Army is all around diversity and inclusion.
Mm.
What does that mean, Gus?
Yeah, well, we had a chief who's, you know, David Morrison, who's pretty famous around the world for a three-minute YouTube video. What came out of that for most of us was, firstly, an acknowledgement that that we had a problem. It's a bit like saying someone, you know, the biggest thing, if you've got an alcohol problem, you better admit you've got one to start with. Well, I think what we looked at ourselves, and we were representing a relatively small part of this dynamic Australian community, and we've got to draw recruits from the whole community, and then we've got to defend the whole community. But I think there's a point that I stress to our people. The world is complex. The environment we're in is dynamic and complex. So when I'm in a team looking at that complexity, I actually want a diverse set of views. So I think we've moved beyond, you know, the need to talk about diversity because of that, of the bad behavior that David Morrison had identified. I think we're now looking at how do you create diverse teams as high performance teams? And I think in the business world, you know, the global financial crisis exposed that you know, those organisations that had diverse leadership teams, whether it was at board level or was in the management team, absolutely. Performed better.
Yep.
We've seen some evidence in things like global adventure racing, you know, where in many of the sports, women are teams are required to have a female member. What we see is a different leadership decision-making process. It's better. It's broader. So for us, it's not just about gender. It's about different cultural experiences, different background, different socioeconomic experience. And then when we go out in the world, which is complex and dynamic, we reckon we're going to be better placed to make better decisions. Now diverse teams are harder to lead. Everyone knows that. So this takes energy and effort. And we're not perfect. We've got work to do. But we think there's good operational reasons for having the most diverse teams that we can build.
And diverse is all the above, is it?
I think it is all of the above. Let's not get fixated on any element. When I look around my team and I'm looking at a complex problem set, I want the widest set of opinions that I can get. And I've got to have created a leadership environment where everyone feels comfortable having their say. But also got a simple sort of statement, I guess, Greg.
Mm-hmm.
We defend all of Australia, and all of Australians are entitled to come and be part of that defensive system. Now, there's a bit of a focus on this women in combat business.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that.
Yeah. Look, and here's my vision. You know, I've just got a vision in my head of this last big exercise. We're out on Shoulder Bay watching a young female soldier with a drone control system strapped to her front, like a laptop computer, 3D immersive headset on, and she's piloting a drone that's as big as a dining room table that's forward over the adversary, watching everything they do, and if necessary, you know, dropping bombs on their head. So this kind of idea that this anachronistic view that sort of women in combat means a female infantry person, you know, running up the hill to put a bayonet in, you know, that's an out of date view. Yeah, I've seen some lethal young women controlling swarms of drones. I'm a tank guy. You know, I've seen some of the sharpest tank gunners in our army now are our female tank gunners. So I think getting over this view that combat, you know, was the Napoleonic charge up the hill. That's still necessary. There's still a bunch of people in our army who want to do that. Yep. By the way, I was never one of them myself. And interestingly, there's some elite.
You're in the tank cruising.
I tell you, I mean, the biggest problem is if someone hands you a brew and a sandwich at the same time. You know, what do you do? So, I think the reality is there are some elite young CrossFit athletes, female athletes who are in our infantry today.
Yeah.
We've got, I think the platoon leader of the recon and surveillance platoon of one of our battalions. So a step just short of special forces entry. You know, a young female lieutenant who is as tough as old rope. The numbers are small, and I think that will probably always be the case. But broadly, women are already bringing, you know, significant skills to that combat environment.
Gus, one of the things you learn in business, if you go into battle or you go into competition and you may lose that pitch and you come back and you review it, can you just sort of give us an idea about how you guys talk about strategy, review and development? And how do you get better?
Yeah, look, I think one of the main leadership changes that's happened over my sort of career journey, I think in those early days, the more senior officers were very removed, aloof, weren't subject to sort of scrutiny and review.
So this is the old guard.
The old guard.
Is this the Vietnam vets?
Probably that,
previous,
that group who probably came out of that period, Korean War, Vietnam War. We went into this period and the Americans importantly introduced this notion of the after-action review.
Yeah.
Put your organization through a demanding test. Everybody then is scrutinized from the leader down.
This is Colin Powell?
And so it came out of that period, Colin Powell, Norman Schwarzkopf, and they created these combat training centers, and they'd taken their Vietnam experience where they didn't perform well and they decided they were going to do something about it. And it created a fundamental change in that level of scrutiny for leaders. There was a toxic period at the start where leaders who weren't as successful as they could have been were simply sacked and removed immediately. I think we've now reached a point where this is part of a training cycle. And if someone repeatedly is not performing in an important role that may have consequences for soldiers' lives, they get removed. But I think we've now reached an environment where we put our leaders and, you know, I'm responsible for developing combat brigades. We put whole brigades, 4,000 people into a dynamic box, as we call it, whole range of scenarios they're not expecting. And we watch everybody from the brigadier through the leading staff. And there, everything is digitally recorded. We can map the location of every individual. We can play back these scenarios. And that's led to a level of sophistication in that training process. So it's really about, you know, how did that deal, that discussion, that development go? And then running the detail through it and being honest and open with ourselves. What could we have done better? And we actually get the leader to stand up and say what they, you know, he or she think could have been done better. And then we run the evidence, right? You're exactly right. Here's what we saw. This, you know, this part of the organization got lost because you didn't have control measures and guides. And so I think that's led to a very different leadership climate out there where by the time you get to the operation, by the time you deploy to southern Afghanistan, you've been three or four times through that ringer.
Yep.
And so and often the ringer is worse than the reality that you find. You always have twice as many enemy in the in that exercise where you're testing than happens on the ground. So I think what that's created is actually added to an authentic layer to our leadership because the more junior members are now watching the boss on their feet, being willing to admit they got things wrong, been showing how hard they've got to work to do their job.
Yep.
It's actually led to a level of kind of openness and authenticity in our leadership that wasn't around when I was a young person.
Speaking of veterans, Gus, do we really value what they can bring to the business world?
I don't think business quite understands the talent that is sitting there, probably a little bit latent. And I'll be honest, we've got some people in the organisation who need to do better at explaining their offer and opportunity. Let me give you an example. My Sergeant Major, the senior soldier in Forces Command, finished in January last year, and he was in contention to be the Sergeant Major of the Army. So we thought an industry placement might be a good way just to expand his leadership understanding. I don't think Boral will mind me mentioning they were great, reached forward and said we'd love to take this bloke, but I don't think they were sure what they were getting. To be honest, he couldn't articulate in business terms what he did. Now, as a leadership team, he's incredibly important to me. He was like, you know, that second, the analogy I use when you've got a great pair of binoculars and you bring the moment when that binocular comes together and you can leap forward and it's working. Well, that's the relationship of the sergeant major and the commander. what Borrell discovered is that amazing thing called the Australian, you know, senior soldier. So Dave went into the organisation. He travels around. He talks to young leaders. He identifies for the senior management who's got talent. He's helped them develop an internal training framework, much like we've got. We talk about being.
So he's looking at culture, behaviours.
Looking for talent, working out how to pass on, you know, how to grow that culture of the company, pass it on to other people. He gives a directed telescope, as we call it. You know, Napoleon used to sit up on the hill, but his trusted aides would ride their horses up, grab his telescope and point to a part of the battle and say, you need to look down there. Well, Dave provides a directed telescope into remote parts of the company that the leadership might not otherwise see. So that's just one guy who's made a very specific impact on a company. Now we've got to do better to help get our people ready to go so they can explain some of those competencies. But I'm passionate about them because I know how good they are. I do know it's a young person's game and we need some people moving through. And so at the end of a long career, these people have got an enormous amount to offer.
Seems like a tremendous opportunity just lost out there from business.
And I guess I'm advertising, you know, broadening the aperture, perhaps simple techniques like having, you might find some alumni in your organisation who are members of the Army or the Army Reserve. Have them sit on a recruiting panel who can just dig in a little bit deeper than the initial question. Be a little bit willing to look past that person who isn't willing to sing, to trumpet their own performance. And a member of the Army at a job interview, if you ask them what their achievements are, they'll say, we have done this, because that's their mindset.
Not the greatest salesman of all time.
Exactly. And so you just need a little bit of perseverance to scratch through and you can find out the enormous potential that's out there.
Technology, it's hitting every company. It's obviously hitting you guys. Mm. Where do you see the future of war?
Yeah, we are in a really dynamic change period. So the impact of particularly data, big data analytics, machine assistance, that's the next leap for us. So we were pretty early on the adoption of robots, for example. We've been using robots to defeat improvised explosive devices rather than put a soldier in there. Yeah. And we've been using drones for some time. Yeah. But the next evolution is when that robot is making semi-autonomous decisions, when it doesn't need as much human guidance, where we might have a manned, unmanned team. Helicopters are really important. They're expensive. You've got a pilot in them. If you can have a couple of semi-autonomous drones who can scout ahead, identify a position. And when I say semi-autonomous, they've got, you know, algorithms running in them that knows what an adversary's weapon system looks like, knows what a person looks like, knows, you know, what a bridge and so on. So we already think that we're already in that transition. Big data analytics are huge for us, as they are for everybody else. So we have surveillance systems that hoover up all sorts of data now. We've got drones, we've got satellite capability, we've got electronic warfare sensors. Yep. We've got more data than we know how to analyze. So how do you run an analytic platform over that? How do you tell an algorithm that somebody in village A has a different name that they legitimately use in village B because of a cultural difference? For years, you know, our analysts would have said, well, we've been watching this guy, never left at village, he can't have planted that bomb.
Yep.
But if we got him on a phone call over here using a different name legitimately, because that's part of their cultural context. So we think data, algorithms, you know, big data analytics, visualization tools are all part of that. But again, none of that is a trivial thing to teach a machine.
And what about sending messages to one baddie to another baddie, et cetera, et cetera? Yep. Are you guys into all that as well?
Oh, absolutely. So effectively, we've tried to create a network, an internet of things for our deployed force.
Quite incredible, isn't it?
Sending a data packet. So we might have a helicopter detector.
Make sure you got your phones off here.
I could tell you some things about carrying a phone another day. So, creating that internet of things where we're moving data more quickly than the enemy. So ultimately, we're always going to be small. And we, you know, increasingly the adversaries can buy the same vehicle or system as us. So the advantage that we will have, we'll all have good people. You know, human performance is a factor, and Australia is pretty good at that.
Yep.
But creating this system of linked sensors and shooters that can act faster than your adversary is the next big thing. And it's not just for Army. So as we look at the Navy and the Air Force, I want an airborne sensor, this AWAC platform that we call it, is overhead. Yep. I want that aircraft to be able to pick up an incoming enemy aircraft and send the data to a land-based tutor.
Yep.
There might be an F-35 overhead in stealth mode that doesn't want to disclose its position. I want it to be able to hand off a target to us. And similarly, we want to be able to pass a target to a ship that might want to engage for us. So all of that is about data packets moving around, low latency.
And even the shooter's rifle these days is built based on data accuracy, right?
Correct. So I want that rifleman sitting next to my vehicle to be able to go, hey, that guy shooting him, he's out of my range, ping a button on the top of their rifle and the nearest tank just slews automatically over to that target and whacks it from, you know, 1,000 metres away. So, and nothing I've just said is science fiction. That's all out there today. It's how as an army, A, you afford it, but B, create that system design so all of those systems talk to each other.
Gus, I think what businesses stand back and admire from the army is that you inherit a lot of people just knocking on the front door, walk in. Are they born or are they made as leaders?
We are very lucky. We are presented with some great young Australians who want to serve. They go, you know, they want to go to the Defence Academy. They want to build on leadership, perhaps instincts and things that they might have already had. Some of them might have been sports captains or house captains at school and so on. But I think it's important we all understand, and this is important for young leaders out there, there are some people who are naturally charismatic and have got high emotional intelligence and they're going to be good leaders. Yeah. And good luck to them. But I think it's really important to understand you can become a good leader, and we are very conscious in Army. We work on training good leaders as well. Some of it's not sexy. Some of it is be really good at your job. People will work for you. Even if you're not naturally charismatic, people will work for you if they think you're working really hard to be good at your job and to be successful. In our case, if their soldiers know a young leader's doing everything they can to keep them alive, doesn't matter if they're not, you know, naturally charismatic. So, you know, professionalism, good at your job, be very clear what your job is and what those of your people are. You know, weaker leaders sort of feel that they have to go down and do everyone else's job to make sure that nothing fails. It's a lovely saying that I saw recently in our caper. If you're leaning back a bit in your leadership role, your subordinates are leaning forward into that space. And so just, you know, be conscious that you've got to let your team grow up into the space. So that means at times taking a little bit of professional risk to give them opportunity.
The risk taking is your business, isn't it?
That's right. And so, you know, I guess in the innovation space in private industry, intelligent failure. We have to be able to create intelligent failure on our training operation, give them a chance to screw it up. The learning rate is probably 80% more effective than perhaps someone who's for everything that's gone well. I think the other thing that we talk about is this: at the end of the day, if you fundamentally care for your people, they will respond. I talk to our young leaders in the army. If you care more for your soldiers than you do about your own success, they will respond, and ultimately you'll outperform those who are trying to make themselves look good. So there's just a couple of ideas. I think at the end of the day, you know, working hard, taking your job seriously, be willing to develop your team, occasionally risk that they might fail because you've given them some space, and care deeply about them. You follow those rules, you're going to do okay.
There's one thing which is a glue in every organisation. They try to talk, everyone has a different one, it's called culture.
Mm.
Now, the Australian Army is based on things, you know, called a very simple word called teamwork.
Mm.
Now, not every organisation has that sort of authenticity in team. How would you describe, you know, the value of teamwork? Because that's what it comes down to, I would have thought.
Yeah, that you ask any, going back through history, you ask a soldier who they fought for in that moment of grimness, of panic, of fear of darkness. They fought for the person next to them. And then broadly, you know, and out, we're lucky that we are, I've been privileged to have 36 years as part of an organisation with this incredible tradition, goes back 117 years, called the Australian Army. But there's two things I think about that. That customs and traditions are an important part of that, knowing you belong to something bigger than yourself. And there's some great institutional organisations out there in Australia. We need big banks to be successful. We need big businesses to be successful because this country needs to be successful. We can be proud of the history of those organisations just like we're proud of our army. But you've got to be careful, of course, that you can innovate. So I talk about innovating from a firm base of our customs and traditions. You know, we still salute each other and we have certain traditions, but they provide a platform that you still must innovate from and be as vibrant as you can. So the culture of an organisation, you've got to hold to an important part of continuity, but you've also got to be looking for you know, the changes and the opportunities that come with the future.
Why did you join the Army, Gus?
I'm a, it's a great question. I think there's a perception out there that most sort of leaders in the Army are born with a silver spoon in their mouth. You know, General Rick Burr, the new chief of the Army, and I have been best mates since we were 17 and a half. We arrived at the military college together. Rick's dad sold farm machinery in Renmark in South Australia, and my mum was raised by a single mother who was a high school teacher. And my sister was off at university, and I knew that was about as much as my mum could handle. And so I came to an organisation that gave me this incredible opportunity to grow and learn and be developed at the same time as, you know, cutting my mum a bit of slack. So a long time ago, wasn't sure how long that'd last. That soldier was waiting up, made me a hot brew, might have started something. Probably if I could find him now, he might regret it, but that's too late. So I think most Australians should understand this is a great institution for meritocracy, for egalitarian development, for bringing on of great people. And I was very lucky. It found me, or I just happened to have been given far more than I think I've offered back in return.
You're finishing up fairly soon, Gus. If you had the chance, what would you change in the Australian Army?
Oh, huge question. Look, I think our weakness is still some of those institutional parts of an organisation, and this I think is probably the same of everybody. Things like hierarchical change of command, siloed structures. Our biggest challenge in Army is we have very highly developed trade and training structures, and they're for good reason. We have a remuneration tribunal that's independent, and to get pay rises for your soldiers, you write all these, you know, detailed job descriptions, but they become really difficult things to change. So I would love to have blown a bit more of that apart, Greg, in my time. I ran out of time, and they all sort of know it too. They're looking at me thinking, thank God he's gone. I think every big organisation's got to look for those institutional sort of rocks that are sitting there that are harder to get moving and chip away at them. I missed a couple.
Gus, I can't ask for any more than your time today. Thanks very much for joining. It's been a wonderful show. Thanks for joining No Limitations.
Hey, thanks for having me. It's been great fun.